Magnetic moment or magnetic dipole moment is a physical quantity that gives an idea about the magnetic strength and orientation of a bar magnet or any other physical object that might replicate the behavior of a bar magnet. By replicating the behavior, I mean there are physical objects which can behave from far away as if they have a magnetic field of their own and as if that magnetic field consists of a north pole and a south pole. There are particles in nature such as electrons, protons, neutrons which also behave as tiny bar magnets of their own. In today's video, I want to discuss the nuclear magnetic moment or the magnetic moment of nuclear particles such as neutrons and protons. But before we go into that, let's first start the discussion from a very basic physical example. In this case, we have the example of a circular current loop. So you probably already know that if you have a wire in which a current is moving, then there are magnetic field lines around that particular wire because of the current itself. Now, if you have a circular current loop in which there is a current I flowing through it, then there are going to be magnetic field lines around that particular circular current loop. And because of these magnetic field lines from far away, this kind of a physical object will also behave like a tiny bar magnet of its own. And the magnetic moment, which will basically give us an idea about the strength of its magnetic field and the orientation of this magnetic field, is given by the current of the wire multiplied by the area of this particular loop itself. Now, this kind of an example of a current moving around a circular loop can also be compared to other physical examples. For example, the motion of an electron around a nucleus. So inside an atom, you have a nucleus at the center and there is an electron revolving around it. Now, since electrons are charged particles of their own, we can consider the motion of the electron around a nucleus to be that of the flow of a current. So here you can imagine that there is an electron moving around a nucleus which is situated at the center. This motion of the electron can be assumed to behave as that of the flow of a current. So in the same way that if there is a current flowing in a circular loop, there is a magnetic moment associated with that circular loop. The motion of the electron around a nucleus also has a magnetic moment associated with it. And we can calculate the magnetic moment by performing a very simple calculation. So for example, if you imagine that there is a nucleus at the center and an electron moving around the nucleus, then the current associated with the motion of the electron will simply be given by charge per unit time. Charge is here the electronic charge, and time is basically the time period of revolution for the electron to complete one revolution around the nucleus, which is basically equal to the circumference of the orbit divided by the orbital velocity. If I put this expression here in the current itself, I get this expression where current is basically EV upon 2 pi r. So now the magnetic moment is basically current multiplied by area, where area here is the area of the orbit itself, which is pi r square, and I we have just calculated right now. If I cancel some of these terms in the numerator and denominator, I end up getting the magnetic moment is equal to EVr upon 2. Obviously, there is a negative sign because we are talking about the electronic charge or the motion of the electron, which has a negative charge associated with it. So basically, you have the magnetic moment, which is equal to minus EVr by 2. If you multiply the mass of the electron in the numerator and the denominator, you end up getting EmVr by 2m. Now, what is mVr? mVr is nothing but the angular momentum associated with the motion of the electron around a nucleus. Since the electron is revolving around the nucleus, it has an orbital angular momentum associated with its motion. So if I replace mVr with L, which is the orbital angular momentum of the electron, then I end up getting the magnetic moment, which is equal to mu is equal to minus E capital L upon 2m. E is the electronic charge, m is the mass of the electron, L is the orbital angular momentum, and mu is the magnetic moment associated with the orbital motion of the electron. Now, this is an expression that we have obtained by looking at the classical picture of the electron revolving around the nucleus. The quantum mechanical expression, which gives an idea about the quantum mechanical equivalent of the magnetic moment of quantum particles, also has a similar kind of an expression with a little bit of a correction involved. However, before we go there, let's first look at a very important conclusion that we can derive from this expression. E and m here are constants, 2 is a number. The only two variables are L and nu. So the angular momentum L is associated with the magnetic moment. So what happens is that whenever there is a particle which has a charge of its own and an angular momentum associated with its motion, then in that case that particle also has a magnetic moment associated with its motion. So the magnetic moment of any particle, essentially you can say, is a result of two things. First of all, the intrinsic charge that the particle has, and second of all, the angular momentum associated with its motion. Whenever a charged particle having some kind of a charge is involved in some kind of an rotational motion where there is an angular momentum associated with it, in that case, it will result in a magnetic moment for that particular particle. In this case, we have a charged electron revolving around the nucleus, resulting in a magnetic moment of the electron around the nucleus. So therefore, here I have written that the magnetic moment is directly proportional to angular momentum. Because the rest are all constants, the larger the angular momentum is, the larger is going to be the magnetic moment of this kind of a scenario. However, the orbital angular momentum is not the only kind of angular momentum associated with an electron's motion. There is another angular momentum which is also associated with the motion of an electron, which is known as spin angular momentum. Now, spin angular momentum, as opposed to this one, in this case you have the angular momentum associated with the revolution of the electron. The spin angular momentum is an intrinsic property of the electron itself. Whether an electron is in a bound state or whether it is a free electron, it will always have a spin angular momentum associated with its existence. So this spin angular momentum will also contribute towards a magnetic moment of the electron. So the spin angular momentum will also create a magnetic moment whose expression is also similar to this. Here I have written the magnetic moment due to the orbital angular momentum of the electron, and this is the magnetic moment due to the spin angular momentum of the electron. Now G here is a correction factor because this is the expression derived from a classical point of view. The quantum mechanical magnetic moment has a similar expression, albeit with a correction factor associated with it, which is given by basically G. G is known as the G factor or a correction factor. For the case of the orbital angular momentum, that is when the electron is revolving around the nucleus, the correction factor G has a value of 1. And for the case of a spin magnetic moment, where we are only talking about the magnetic moment due to a electron spin motion, the correction factor G has a value of approximately equal to 2. So thus you can see that the electron revolving around the nucleus has a magnetic moment of its own, and the electron itself also has a magnetic moment of its own. And the total magnetic moment of the electron would basically be a vector sum of its motion around the nucleus as well as its own intrinsic spin angular momentum. Thus we can conclude that the electron in a nucleus as well as the electron in its own behaves as a tiny bar magnet which has a magnetic field of its own, and therefore it will behave in the same way that a bar magnet will behave. In this case, GL represents the G factor for orbital motion, and GS represents the G factor for spin motion, and L represents the angular momentum for orbital angular momentum, and S represents the angular momentum for spin angular momentum. If you have followed my earlier videos, I have made a previous video in which I talked about the angular momentum of an electron as well as other nuclear particles, and I have used a few quantum mechanical expressions for them, such as these expressions, which basically give you an idea about the quantization of orbital angular momentum and the quantization of spin angular momentum. So the magnitude of the orbital angular momentum is given by root over small l, l plus 1 h cross, where small l is the azimuthal quantum number which can take values of 1, 2 up to n minus 1. And Lz basically gives you the component of the orbital angular momentum in the direction of an external magnetic field. Here we have the magnitude of the spin angular momentum, which is root over small s, s plus 1 h cross, where small s can take value of half. And Sz is basically the component of the spin angular momentum in the direction of an external magnetic field, where ms can take two values of plus minus half. Now, if you are interested in how these expressions came about and what is the physical meaning behind the quantization of these expressions, I will put a link of that video in the description, and you can look up that video to understand how these expressions manifest themselves or what is the physical meaning behind these kind of expressions. However, what I want to say here in this video is that these are the expressions for the angular momentum of the orbital motion as well as the spin motion, and we can apply them here to get a much different kind of expression for the magnetic moment. So the magnetic moment for the orbital motion can simply be written as minus GL upon E by E h cross upon 2m L upon h cross. Why have I written h cross here? Because L basically comes in units of h cross itself. Similarly here, the magnetic moment can simply be written as minus Gs E h cross upon 2m s upon h cross. Now the reason I have written in this manner is that because E h cross by 2m is nothing but a constant, and this is a very important constant because this is known as a Bohr magneton. So these are Bohr magnetrons. Here, of course, G has the values of 1 and 2 respectively. L and S has the values given by the particular situation at hand. And U, mu B is basically a Bohr magneton, which is a constant. And as you can see, the magnetic moment of an electron, whether it is an orbital motion or whether it's spin motion, will always come in quantized values in units of mu B. That's why we give importance to the Bohr magneton. And the Bohr magneton has a value of 5.78 into 10 to the power minus 5 electron volts per Tesla. Now, in the same way that we have expressed the magnetic moment of electrons for its orbital motion and spin motion in this particular manner, we can also represent the magnetic moments of nuclear particles like neutrons and protons in a similar fashion, where instead of using this Bohr magneton, we will use another quantity which is known as nuclear magneton, where instead of having the electron's mass, we will have the mass of a proton. So in the same way that for electrons, the magnetic moment comes in units of the Bohr magneton, in the case of nuclear particles like protons and neutrons, the nuclear magnetic moment comes in terms of the nuclear magneton. So the nuclear magneton has a mass involved, which is now the mass of the proton instead of the mass of the electron in the case of the Bohr magneton. And since the mass of the proton is greater compared to the mass of the electron, the nuclear magneton also has a value which is smaller compared to the Bohr magneton itself. Now, I already told you that the magnetic moment is basically a result of two things. First of all, an intrinsic charge that the particle has and an angular momentum. So whenever a charged particle has an angular momentum, then that particle will have a magnetic moment associated with it. Now, obviously, for the case of a proton, it is obvious, proton is positively charged. You might ask the question that why is it the case that for the neutron also you have a magnetic moment? Neutrons are neutral particles that do not have any charge. The reason is that even though neutrons have a net charge of zero, neutrons are made up of much more fundamental particles which have fractional charges of their own. So the neutron has some kind of a spin angular momentum associated with it. The neutron is further made up of smaller particles which have a charge of their own, and therefore there is a charge distribution inside the volume of the nucleus, and that effectively leads to the nucleus having a magnetic moment. However, in the case of the neutron, the magnetic moment is in their direction opposite to the direction of the spin angular momentum, and in the case of the proton, the magnetic moment is in the direction of the spin angular momentum itself. If I want to calculate what is the magnetic moment of a neutron and a proton, I'm going to use the similar expression that I used in the case of an electron. However, in the case of an electron, we had an angular momentum S, which was given by this kind of a quantization rule. In the case of the neutrons and protons also, we have a similar kind of an expression, because neutrons, protons and electrons, they are all spin half particles, and their spin angular momenta is given by this particular expression, where the first expression gives you the magnitude of the spin angular momenta and the second expression gives you the component of the spin angular momenta towards a Z axis. So if I want to represent the or quantify the total amount of magnetic moment for neutrons and protons, I would simply use this expression that I use for the case of electrons also. If I want to distill it a little bit further, what I can do is I can apply these values here. So SZ, what does SZ represent? Just to give you a recap, if you have not watched my video on quantization of angular momentum, just take a look at that video. You'll get an idea about why these expressions come and what is the meaning behind these expressions. Let me just give you a simple recap. The recap is that what is SZ here? So if basically there is some kind of a particle, let's suppose, which has a spin and a rotational motion associated with its existence, and this particle is put in the presence of some kind of an external magnetic field. So if there's a magnetic field in the Z-axis, then what happens is that usually these particles, they have a magnetic moment. What is the meaning of a particle having magnetic moment? It means that it is behaving like a small bar magnet. Now, what happens to a bar magnet when it is placed in the presence of an external magnetic field? It will try to align itself in the direction of the external magnetic field. However, the direction in which the angular momentum of these particles like electrons, protons and neutrons exist are quantized in nature. That means electrons, neutrons and protons are not free to orient themselves in any arbitrary direction in space, but rather their direction in which their spin angular momentum is facing towards is quantized and restricted by the system they are present in. In fact, they are restricted by these quantization rules. So if there is a neutron or a proton which has some kind of a spin angular momentum in space and it is put in the place of an external magnetic field, then what is going to happen is that this neutron is going to precess around the Z-axis, or it is going to precess around the external magnetic field in this particular manner so as to revolve in a conical section. Similarly, since SZ can have two values, plus minus H cross, it simply means that it can have a Z component of plus H cross, or it can have a Z component of minus H cross. So either it can precess in a plus H cross conical section, or it can precess in a minus H cross conical section. So the spin angular momentum can only have two values along the direction of an external magnetic field, plus H cross by 2 and minus and its h cross by 2. If I put these values in both the case of a proton and a neutron here, I will use a similar expression that I use in the case of an electron. So if I put Sz is equal to ms h cross, where this value simply comes out to be plus minus h cross by 2, h cross gets cancelled, you have 2 remaining in the denominator. Similarly, in the case of here also, h cross gets cancelled, you have 2 remaining in the case of a denominator. Now the g factor for the case of a proton is 5.5858 and the g factor for a neutron is minus 3.8263. If I put these values, I find that the magnetic moment of a proton in the direction of an external magnetic field comes out to be plus minus 2.793 nuclear magneton, and the magnetic moment of a neutron in the direction of an external magnetic field comes out to be around minus plus 1.913 nuclear magneton. Now this is, here is plus minus, because as I already told you, the magnetic moment and the spin angular momenta for case of a proton is in the same direction, while here it is a minus plus because the magnetic moment and the spin angular momenta for a neutron are in opposite directions. Now, as I already told you, that if a neutron or a proton or an electron, which are basically tiny bar magnets, they are put in the presence of an external magnetic field, they cannot orient themselves in any arbitrary direction in space, but rather their directions are quantized by, which is known as the Sz quantization rule. So according to this quantization rule, it can either precess in this particular conical section or it can precess in this particular conical section. The energy corresponding to these two different directions are not equal, and therefore it leads to splitting up of the energy levels of either protons, neutrons, or electrons in the presence of an external magnetic field. Now, if there's a proton and that proton has an energy of E naught and that proton is placed in the presence of an external magnetic field, then that proton, because this proton has a magnetic moment of its own, can orient itself in two different directions. So it can orient itself in this particular direction so that it precesses around the external magnetic field, so that the magnetic moment corresponding to the external magnetic field will be plus h cross by 2, or it can precess in this direction so that it has a z component of minus h cross by 2. So basically, the proton can have a magnetic moment of two values in the direction of the external magnetic field, plus h cross by 2 and minus h cross by 2. Therefore, the magnetic energy of any given bar magnet in the presence of external magnetic field is given by minus nu dot b, where this is equal to minus nu b cos theta. So nu cos theta is nothing but the component of the magnetic field in the direction of the z axis or direction of the external magnetic field. So this is nothing but the z component of mu into b. Now if I take the example of a proton, the proton has a proton z component can have two values. It can have the positive value or it can have a negative value. So in the case of a positive value, basically this is represented by the spin up. So the spin up basically has a negative total magnetic energy. And for the case of a negative value, because negative negative becomes positive, so the for the spin negative, you have a total of positive energy. So therefore, the total energy of the proton basically gets split into two parts corresponding to whether the proton is having spin down or spin up. So in the case of the spin down, you basically end up getting higher energy. In the case of spin up, you end up getting lower energy. And this is basically the energy difference between these two split lines, which is equal to 2 mu p z b. And the frequency corresponding to difference in energy between these two levels is known as Larmor frequency. And this kind of a phenomenon is exploited in different kinds of experimental setups also, like for the example of nuclear magnetic resonance. So to summarize, I would like to state that if there's a particle which has some kind of an intrinsic charge, or at least it is made up of charge particles, and it also has an intrinsic angular momentum, then that kind of a particle will have a magnetic moment associated with it, and therefore it will behave as a tiny bar magnet. And we can calculate the associated magnetic moment in this fashion that I have shown in this particular video for the case of electrons, for the case of neutrons, and for the case of protons. And that's it for today's video. I hope you have learned something. See you in the next one.